And it is good to see some familiar faces from back home, because yeah, at some point I was planning to be back to visit family and see some people, but that didn't quite happen, as we all know why. So yeah, if there are questions, feel free to chuck them in or ask them live. I'm happy to take them as we go along, and I'll get underway. So, for those of you that don't know me, I used to be at Utrecht for quite a while, where both in the groups of Edwin Cuppe and Jeroen de Ridder, I did interesting bioinformatics stuff, mostly on human genomics. So I didn't necessarily expect to be working that much on a particular pathogen when I decided to move over to New Zealand about 2 years ago. But here we are. So about 2 years ago, there was an opportunity to come over to what is called ESR, which is an institute here in New Zealand that basically cares about the health of people. So there's public health, but there's also forensics, food safety, and the water and environment side of things that is being covered. And genomics is an important part of that. So that's what I'll be presenting about today, is the work that we've done, and specifically about SARS-CoV-2. So this is not a slide to make you jealous, but to put some things in perspective. And that is that I'm presenting, even though it is the middle of the night, from a position that is possibly a bit surreal to some of you, since that I've been living the last year mostly in what we would consider freedom in terms of movement or things that you can go and do. And that is largely because we had a fairly decisive government and successful action to keep the virus out. So we ran what is referred to as an elimination strategy. So what we see here on the left-hand side is a COVID resilience ranking about how different countries have responded to the pandemic, where we see quite some South Asian and Pacific countries that have taken a strong approach and are therefore ranked highly. And then, unfortunately, a bit lower, Europe and some other countries that didn't fare as well. The other thing that I'm touching on today is the fact that, in terms of legislation and countermeasures, we are still coming to grips with the fact that this is an airborne virus. And there's a really nice piece of writing in the New York Times that came out a couple of days ago about why it took us quite a bit of a long time to accept the facts about COVID, and specifically about the airborne nature of it. Since that one of the things that they write is that there was these increasing amounts of mostly epidemiological studies that showed that COVID-19 was spreading primarily indoors, and that clusters were concentrated around these poorly ventilated spaces. So this is about, like, it's not just the droplets. It is about more than just that. And some of the studies that we were able to perform, I hope, have contributed to that understanding of the virus. The other thing to note is that coming from a genomics background in Utrecht, for me, this was very much a pandemic in the genomics era. And I think this is sort of reflected in the timeline here, where back in the days, on the 31st of December, the WHO was notified of a new pathogen, a virus. And already on the 11th of January, there was the publication of the first SARS-CoV-2 genome. For most other viruses of this type, that typically took a year or more for that to occur. So this was truly a big change. This meant that we could start developing these diagnostic assays that are now being used to test whether you have the virus. But it also meant that some of the vaccines that were the sort of the first to hit the market, the RNA vaccines, could also already start development on the back of some of the earlier work that had been done for other coronaviruses and these types of things. And already on the 23rd of January, there was the first sequencing protocol that was designed by the Arctic Network to sequence the virus from clinical samples, which allowed us to do contact tracing. And in the current day of age, it allows us to monitor new variants of the virus. And there's a really nice piece that sort of influenced my thinking heavily within this, but also of others around the globe, was written about the future of real-time pathogen surveillance in Nature a couple of years back, about how you can do these kind of things in real time. So things like the processing of a sample, but also the bioinformatics data analysis that comes from that, and how you then integrate that with metadata about people's movements, contacts, etc., to come to actionable reports and do that in a way that people can understand it in terms of visualizations and conclusions. So this was all happening in real time, and because we also live in the Twitter day and age, I think this is one of the famous tweets, or at least it will be a famous tweet from Edward Holmes on January 11th about the initial genome sequence that was released. And then a little bit later, Josh Quick from the Arctic Network offering some of the reagents that you could put your hands up, because by that time, of course, the big companies were not making those. So they were sending aliquots of samples round so that you could start your sequencing workflows. The other good thing is that it was all being shared openly. So the protocols were all available on protocols.io. And that these things relied on Oxford Nanopore, which meant that even some of the smaller labs could get started with that without needing too much of a capital investment. We put up our hand for some reagents, and that meant that when in March the first case arrived in New Zealand, we were able to sequence that roughly within 24 hours of receiving that sample. So for us, that was a nice proof of principle that we can do these genomics in real time as well. Now, why did we focus on Nanopore? Because we already had Illumina sequencers in-house. We, of course, used that as well, especially when we're doing larger volumes of samples. And we evaluated both, but what we found is that we were obtaining identical genomes, but there was one real big difference, and that was in terms of the turnaround times, where theoretically you could get turnaround times less than 12 hours for urgent samples if you were using the Nanopore. And that has to do with the fact that you can start analyzing the data as it is being generated, and at the moment that you have enough data, you can start making your consensus genomes and doing your interpretation and analysis. And the other important thing is that it is affordable to do with a few number of samples. So you don't necessarily need 1,000 samples to be economical with that approach. Since then, James Ferguson from Australia did a really nice paper on sort of the economy of scale of Illumina versus Nanopore and the accuracy of that, because that is something that a lot of people still worried about, like, Nanopore, is that accurate enough? The conclusion is yes, very much so. And as he also highlights there in that paper, that it can be done within hours rather than days, which is quite important if you want to do these things in real time. And the other thing to note there is that one of the protocols that we actually use for the rapid sequencing is the 1200 base pair protocol, which is something that was actually developed here by Massey University in New Zealand, which is also referred to as the Midnight Protocol. which is sort of appropriate since I'm presenting after midnight. So why genomic surveillance? I'm guessing most of you are familiar, but just very quickly, we wanted to do it because we thought it was useful to assist in outbreak investigations. We were seeing what sort of impact this virus was having globally, and we thought that we need all the data that we can get on this particular virus if we want to combat it. It is an independent line of evidence next to the typical epidemiological investigations of contact tracing. Virus genomes have slightly better memories than some humans. It also allows us to estimate the number of introductions into the country. So where is it coming from and how often is it coming in? It allows us to determine the chain of transmission, and therefore it also allows us to study in a bit more detail how transmissible it is, or how many people are being infected by one particular individual. And also, how is it spreading and what sort of settings? And that comes back to the understanding of what sort of virus we're dealing with. Understanding in what sort of settings it's spreading and how it's spreading within that is really important. I saw that Bjørn Snell was joining the call, so I hope I'll do it justice here. When I was first looking into the virus genome and how to do the bioinformatics for that, some of his lectures came back to me. So this is about phylogenomics and how we do that, or phylodynamics. The luxury situation that we're in with SARS-CoV-2 is that because we had that very early genome, we know what the root of the tree looks like. But typically what is done is that you can infer that from genome sequences if you know the dates that they've been sampled at. It combines with the fact that a mutation that is seen in all sequences typically occurs earlier in time, and therefore is at the root of your tree, compared to mutations that you only see in a couple of samples. So this is just a schematic overview of how you then go about to go from genome sequences to a tree, and therefore transmission chain. So for example, if we would see a novel genome that has the red mutation that is seen in both D and E, in terms of the tree, we would know that it comes typically after that. So we only have to focus on that part of the tree in terms of cases, if we have a question about who was the source of that infection. So what we obtained to date, for New Zealand, there's just over 1,400 past genomes. So that's where we get more than 50% of the genomes recovered, which represents roughly 54% of all cases that we've had. This includes historic cases and cases that have been detected by antigen testing, and not necessarily only through active infection. So in terms of the samples that we received, we were able to generate a genome for about 83% of those. And this is very much due to the fact that we have used these sometimes quite sensitive protocols to try to get as many of the genomes as possible. So internationally, typically people say that if you have a CT value, so that's a reflection of the amount of virus that is in the sample, of above 35, which means low amounts of virus, they typically don't attempt genome sequencing. We have done that, and we've had some success in those types of samples. So what did we learn from doing all that sequencing? Well, there was the first wave, and the big thing that we saw, and that was also seen by the modeling group that was also working on this from a sort of population modeling perspective, was that there were these large super spreading events. So one of the figures from our first wave is that 20% of the adult cases were responsible for about 65 to 85% of the transmission chains, that it was mostly seeded by international travelers, but that the actual spread of it was very much driven by local transmission. And this is what we've seen in other countries around the world as well, is that once it gets in, it's that local spread that really gets you. But thanks to our lockdown and elimination approach, there were actually relatively few cases that led to onward transmission. And that's also reflected in the genomic data. We estimate that there have been about 277 separate introductions into our country during that first wave. We also found that lockdowns work when done well, is a caveat that I will include for this audience, since that one of our most important clusters was a large event that was seeded from the US, where in the initial phase, there was a reproductive number of 7, which means that it was spreading quite rapidly in a group of people, which puts it well above numbers for SARS on average. But that after the lockdown happened, that quickly reduced to a value of below 0.5, therefore meaning that that cluster was very effectively controlled and reduced in its size. So the elimination strategy, one of the things that I think is very important is that there was also a lot of communication around this. What does this mean? It doesn't mean just lockdowns. Lockdowns are still a fairly crude measure in all of that, but they are very effective at achieving some things that you want to achieve to get elimination. So one of the models that works really well and that was also used in a lot of the communications was the Swiss cheese model. And it is about that realization that every measure that you put in place will have leaks and something will come through. So you will need multiple of those and you will need different ones at different settings at different times. So there are the border closures and border control, which is still ongoing and limiting the number of introductions into the country. We have a quarantine system where travelers are being isolated and rapidly tested so that there's minimal exposure risks from those travelers. When we had it in the community, we have had those lockdowns, and that means that there is a limit on size gatherings, schools and workplaces, so typically the indoor settings that are prohibited or at least minimized. Then there's the sort of personal things that you can all do in terms of your own physical distancing, hand washing, safe coughing and sneezing measures, and then staying at home if you're sick and cleaning those surfaces. So it's a combination of these things that make for a successful elimination strategy. It's not just lockdowns, but they are an important part of it. So fast forward from that initial wave to when we locked down fairly hard to August, when there was a reemergence of the virus into our community. By that time, we had set up a lot of the procedures for reporting as well, in terms of having visualizations that we could put in front of our public health units and help them with contact tracing and understanding what was happening. And genomes were being routinely generated in real time. So the first cases were per routine sequenced within 12 hours of detection. And it was a lineage, meaning that there was a set of mutations that hadn't been seen in New Zealand since March, which meant that one of the initial reports that we sent out included a line about that it was unlikely to be undetected transmission within New Zealand, since that we didn't see a lot of mutations in it as well. And we would have expected that if it would have been circulating for 1 or 2 months in our communities. And it was much more consistent with being a reintroduction. But the other thing is that we were sequencing most of the cases in our managed quarantine system, or MIQ as we call it for short, and we didn't find any direct links there. So we had missed something. As more cases appeared, we did see that they were all sharing a common mutation, and that over time they followed a pattern that is consistent with a single chain of transmission, meaning that it was very likely to be one single introduction into our country, which of course meant that contact tracing could focus more strongly on that potential incursion source. And the other thing is that we could also, due to the global data sharing efforts, could place it in a global context, where we saw that it was most likely introduced from Europe at that point in time. It did mean that we could have a more restricted lockdown, since that it was most likely one incursion. So that meant that we could have a more localized lockdown on the region where that incursion had happened. And it also meant that we could provide some information about contact tracing in those instances where there were no clear epidemiological links. We could provide some certainty and some indications about where infections might have happened. And also one of the staff members that was providing care for people, we could also indicate which of those people was most likely where that contact had occurred. Fast forward a little while further is where we saw a group of travelers that were incoming into New Zealand, and they had highly similar genomes. Six of them were identical, and one of them had one additional mutation. And these were identical to some genomes that we had seen internationally, especially from the UK and Switzerland. So we were wondering if this might have been a shared exposure source in their country of departure, or if there might be something going on within our hotels or within airplanes. So we contacted our public health unit and our ministry and started an investigation about these cases. And it transpired that these arrived from vastly different areas of the globe. So we had people from all over, as you can see on the map on the right, which meant that it was unlikely that these people had picked up that exact version of the virus in their country of departure, and more likely that we had to look at their travel or our quarantine system. So we dug deeper. And we found out their seating on the airplane into New Zealand. And as you can imagine, if anyone has ever traveled this way, it is quite a long haul. So there will be people that will eat or move around in the plane. Otherwise, that becomes unhealthy just in itself. But people were wearing masks and doing all the things that they could do to keep safe during that trip, as well as wearing gloves. What we found is that it did seem to center around these two cases that we've colored in blue, so cases A and B, that traveled from Switzerland, where that same virus genome was seen in community cases, and that there were also other people around where they tested negative consecutively on different testing days. So it did seem that there was within the airplane this focal group around them, and with the disease onset progression, which we're showing here in the bottom panel, we think that one or both of them seeded this particular cluster, and that there was then subsequent spread within travel groups in their stay in our managed isolation. This was also noteworthy, the fact that these people that are suspected of seeding the cluster, they had received pre-departure testing, which came back negative. So that was an important piece of information when it came to these pre-departure testings and the utility of those. The other thing that was quite timely about this, and this is just a coincidence, nothing in terms of grant design, is that on the 15th of October, a report was released by the US Transcom about risk of catching COVID-19 in aircrafts. And what you see on the bottom left is what media outlets made of that particular report, saying that it is very hard to contract COVID-19, or almost impossible, or very low. Those types of words were being used. So remembering that our first case tested positive on the 3rd of October, and that this was a collaboration with our ministry and our public health units, we were able to get a preprint up on the 19th of October, showing quite definitively that we had at least a couple of cases, and potentially up to four cases of in-flight transmission from this one or two travelers there. And it just so happened to be that that was the exact same type of aircraft that was used in the US study, with the same types of measures being put in place to prevent spreading. So it was, therefore, even though it's just a case study, one of our most accessed publications in all of this, because it was something that people could use to go and say, like, well, there's one study here saying one thing, but there's some emerging evidence on the other side of things as well that might mean that we need to take a second look of how do we evaluate that transmission and the transmission pathways. There were some other incursions into mostly our border workforce. So those are either people working in the hotels or providing care to the people that got infected, where we could trace the incursions and could help understand how we should adjust our protective measures as well as our operating procedures. And inform the quarantine system on how it could work best. Because coming back to that Swiss cheese model, we were cognizant of the fact that there would be failures. So it's about understanding those failures and then plugging the holes as best as possible. The one in the middle is an interesting one, because by the time that we had discovered those cases in our border workers, it seemed that they had caught it on a ship. But by the time that that was discovered, that ship was in international waters. Luckily, that ship was heading for Australia, where they also have excellent quarantine measures and genomics capabilities. And we're actually able to close that investigation by the genome that they were able to generate that from one of the people that was aboard the ship that was considered to be the source of that particular outbreak. There was also a more complex case, and this really starts to head into the space where there's more definitive evidence of aerosol spread. So again, we had some genomes that looked similar. There was a bit more divergence in this case, but they were too similar for us to just pass up. Where again, we think that there was in-flight transmission, but this time the plot thickened a bit further. Where we think that cases A and B in this case transmitted to case C on the airplane, but then case C was adjacent in the quarantine facility to cases D and E. And upon very rigorous review work by the public health unit and the local laboratories, this included reviewing hours of CCTV footage. There was no direct contact identified between these people. So they spent some more time on looking at other forms of exposure. And what they saw is that there was at one point in time, the door of case C was opened to take their nasopharyngeal swab and then closed again. And seconds later, the door to the room of cases D and E was opened. And there must have been an airflow that occurred into that room, infecting case D in that instance, because no other evidence was found. So it was most likely that airflow. And it's those types of investigations where, with genomics and epidemiological data, that there was this growing body of evidence that SARS-CoV-2 is indeed a aerosolized and infectious virus through that manner of infection. These cases, DNE then unfortunately got onto a charter flight because they got infected very late in their stay in the quarantine facility, which meant that they were not picked up as a positive case prior to being cleared. They tested negative on their last test. And then they were on a charter flight next to case G that then took the virus home to their own household as well, which meant that we had community spread of that. Again, thanks to the very good contact tracing and follow-up work that was all very limited in terms of the number of people that got infected by it. But it does show that there's these holes to be watching out for and to plug them. So one of the things that was done in the quarantine system was that they were putting negative pressures in the room so that there would nothing flow would flow out when the door is opened. And the other thing is that they would do alternate rooms so that there was not that direct airflow from room to room possible after that. One of the things that people asked us, like, so what is it worth that you're doing this in real time? And I think that we in November had a very prudent example of how it is worth it. And this was the point in time where ministers were calling me about one single genome. I was trying to give a presentation at a lab conference at that point in time, and they were hounding me about, is there anything you can do to be quicker? And I told them, we are doing everything we can. And why we were doing that is because Auckland, our largest city, which has a couple of million people living and working in it, was about to go into lockdown over a case because there were no epidemiological links to known cases. So we were able to push the pedal to the metal, and we received a clinical sample in the afternoon, and 7 hours later, we had an actionable report in front of government and our public health units. And what this report showed is that it was genomically linked to a known and ring-fenced cluster, which means that the contact tracing was happening and people were isolating either at home or in quarantine facilities. Therefore, we were fairly certain that it was not a different introduction that was being missed and that it was just part of that larger cluster, and that some very quick follow-up after that actually found some putative links to that cluster, which meant that there could be a much more limited lockdown. So if we assume a level 3 lockdown, which basically means businesses close for just 3 days, that meant that we saved the economy around $130 million. And this was all made possible on the back of just a $2 million investment over a whole year in science, and science being specifically the modeling in terms of predicting how something is going to spread and how many cases we're expecting, and the genome sequencing. And there was a very nice article a couple of days later in Action about how we used science to do a smarter lockdown or even a limited lockdown. And the WHO commented about a unique targeted approach that we were taking. So we like to argue that it is very much worth it to do it like that. This did mean that both the modeling and the genomics work was being done very much in real time, on real time data with real time peer review and real time reporting. If you've ever worried about reviewer 3, about what they think about your paper, now you have to imagine what a bunch of ministers in cabinet think about your report, and also count for the fact that they might be holding up on national television the next day or the next evening. So all of that is things that you're not typically used to dealing with, and you have to work quite closely together with a lot of people, both on phylogenomics as well as epidemiologically. Also in terms of the actual visualizations and the reporting to get that right. I like to think that we got it right, and because of that, our Prime Minister and our Chief Officer of Health came to visit and talk about genomes and trees with us, which was good fun. And it also means that there's people writing these news articles, and then they make quotes about like people hidden in plain sight. And this is a quote that refers to me, that I'm more at home in jeans than in lab coats. So I'm happy that I'm fighting back against the stereotype of scientists always having to wear lab coats, and that we can wear something a slightly bit more colorful. But that this was something that people hadn't heard about probably ever. And now all of a sudden genomics and genomes were becoming a household item across New Zealand. So in terms of genomics education, I think we've never had a larger impact than we've had over the last year. And when it comes to that communication, we were very fortunate here in New Zealand to have some scientists that, apart from their day job, took it upon themselves in a very eloquent way to help people understand what it meant, what we were doing. So this is Suksi Wiles, one of the great science communicators in New Zealand, that was brought to the fore in this pandemic. And she had graphics together with a really good reporter that's working for a New Zealand newspaper and online platform, where they were doing these visualizations and explainer pieces about the modeling, about the genomes, and about what was happening. And just in the year 2020, she was mentioned in our local media more than 1,500 times. And also some of the work that they did was also picked up internationally in terms of explaining what an elimination or a reduction strategy looked like. From the genomic side of things, we were also very cognizant that we were doing this on the back of a social license to study the virus. So we wanted to be very clear to people what it meant that we were sequencing the virus and just the virus, and how we were working with that data. So when in August there was that large outbreak in our major city, we also made publicly accessible narratives where we took the people in a bit more general wording through the investigations that were ongoing and how genomics was factoring into that, and what the probabilities were of these scenarios. And those probabilities were a tricky thing because we knew a priori that something unlikely had happened. And then you are comparing a set of unlikely events to each other and trying to tell people that one is slightly less unlikely than the others. So it comes to that sort of wording and explaining to people why you think that one thing is the most probable. Something else that I'll just touch on very briefly, which I think is of interest to countries that have more cases than we do, is wastewater monitoring. I know that the Netherlands, they have these rolling graphs of how many cases, case equivalents are being detected in wastewater. We have also been active in that space, but again, because we have this unique elimination strategy, we've been taking it from a slightly different angle, and we've been focused mostly on the question of sensitivity. So how many people does it need to be shedding into a certain wastewater source for us to detect it? And here's a very busy graph on the left that I'll touch on shortly. But on the right-hand side is an overview of the people that were in a certain quarantine facility and how many of them there were and what sort of genome they carried. And we can do this because we had near complete coverage of all the people from clinical cases through our regular testing in those quarantine facilities. And we could see that in December 7th, one person was introduced into those facilities with the lineage B1-170, and that on December 10th, a second person was introduced. And that this is a lineage that we've since not seen in New Zealand ever again. So we could look very specifically for that genome in wastewater. And that's what you're seeing on the left is the top panel is again a representation of the clinical cases, but the bottom panel is the wastewater, where the more colored bars you see, the more of B1-170 key mutations we are observing. So some of the mutations it shares with other coronavirus genomes. So that's what we're seeing on the 3rd of December. It's the leftmost panel. Then on the 10th, we didn't observe any virus in the wastewater. But on the 11th, we can see a signal coming up for this particular lineage. And on the 12th, we have a near complete recovery of a B170 genome from wastewater, meaning that these one or two individuals shedding into the wastewater allow us to recover most of that genome. This is something that Piotr will spend a lot more time on, but one of the things that we've been working a lot on in terms of what it means to have truly publicly accessible data. A lot of people work with GizAid, but they have some restrictions on what you can do with their data and the licensing that comes with. And PubSeq is an alternative to that, using also some slightly more programmatically friendly interfaces to do that work. And I'll leave the rest of that to Piotr. But I do think it is important for us to realize that there is still gains to be made in that space. We've also been focusing on a more practical side of that story. And that is that there are a lot of countries in especially our area, but also around the globe that want to do genomic surveillance, but that might be struggling to get it up and running. Because if you're not aware of what Nanopore can do and that it does just as good a job as some other platforms, you might be looking at a fairly large capital investment. So one of the things that Miles Benton, who's working in our group, has been working on is what we call affordable hardware to hook up to your MinION. Because sometimes that comes with the cost of a laptop, which might be hard to source. But what he's found out is that if you have these small Jetson or Xavier boards from NVIDIA, which contain a very small GPU unit, is that you can run a MinION off of that quite easily while still keeping up with real-time data analysis. So that means base calling, also adaptive sampling, and a whole bunch of other things. So what you see here is a setup that costs about $400 in terms of hardware. So that gets you a little screen, a GPU module, and some storage that can run SARS-CoV-2 sequencing just fine. So it has Rampart on it, which is, again, a tool from the Arctic network that allows you to see how the sequencing is progressing, to see when you might have enough data to analyze that. And when you have enough data to analyze, you can upload it to PubSeq, and you should be good to go. So this means that people, we hope to have a short publication about this soon, but through the use of open protocols, affordable off-the-shelf hardware, and what we refer to as a bit more ready-to-go bioinformatics, we hope that we will be enabling other people and communities to get started with them themselves, so that they can generate their own data and make their own conclusions, rather than big consortia doing that for them. And this is something that we're also transitioning into clinical care. We've just started a project with our local hospital where we are trying to get this into their routine clinical testing for urgent cases like sepsis or premature birth cases, where there is a need to quickly understand what the AMR profile of an infection is and what species it is. And on the flip side, we think that using this in diagnostics actually will yield data that is used for surveillance in real time as well. So this is all made possible by funding from two of our major ministries, so the Ministry of Business and the Ministry of Health, as well as some internal funding. And this has been very much a I think an example of what science collaboration can look like when there's a common goal and enough funding to do it. So very acknowledging here the different entities within New Zealand that we've collaborated with heavily, whether that was real-time peer review or phylodynamics expertise. We were very fortunate to have those people working with us on this particular topic. And it takes a team. One of the taglines here in New Zealand that was used to rally people around the common cause is that we were a team of 5 million. So there was a lot of sports analogy that was used. So some of you that like rugby might understand why. But it was very much a team effort across those different institutes and across different disciplines. And this is just a slide to acknowledge that. And I'll be happy to take any questions or comments.
Thanks a lot, you. Thank you so much. Are there any questions for you?
We can also take them after, right?
Yep. If those burning questions go now, I'll be awake. It's okay.
Yeah, you look more awake than I do, man. All right, let me share my screen. Can you see it?
Yes, we can, Peter. Yeah.
Okay. So, Joep, thanks for your amazing presentation and your amazing work. I really think we miss you in the Netherlands. I'm actually based in the Netherlands currently. So even though I'm employed by the University of Tennessee as an assistant professor, I'm living in Groningen. When the lockdown started a year ago, we took the initiative to organize a biohackathon, and it was just an online call to do this virtually. And some 100 plus bioinformaticians participated, and out of that, one of the outputs was what we call PubSeq today. And it's a public data resource with live workflows. And I'll share the link later. So one of the things is that, and one of the drivers for creating PubSeq was that not all so-called public repositories are really open. And we strongly believe this hampers research, and I'll get into that. And there was a piece in Nature quite recently about a call for a fully open sharing of coronavirus genome data. And what it amounts to is that this the largest public resource on the planet, which I'm not gonna name because they hold legal action. They have barriers to entry. Yeah. So, and I'll get into that in a little bit. But the key thing is that we want improved pandemic monitoring, and Joep is championing it because they're obviously far ahead in New Zealand in many ways. And he's using these public resources, and he wants to have more of that, especially when we start to roll out to other places. Now, EBI also launched a new COVID-19 data portal recently. It was only a few weeks back. That's the link. And I'll explain why we still need PubSeq. Oops, sorry. Pressed the wrong button. So PubSeq is about making data available for analysis, and this is a key thing. And do public databases such as EBI ENA and NCBI GenBank and others make PubSeq irrelevant? First of all, PubSeq is an aggregator. So we take data from other public resources. We can also upload data directly, of course. So some data from New Zealand is on PubSeq, and also from Memphis, Tennessee. But it's a key thing that PubSeq federates data. So it's not sitting in one repository. It's spread around the world. We're also adding value by adding metadata, and I'll get into that. We normalize metadata. And we also provide a metadata search engine, which is quite important. Just to give a look, an example, let's talk about the geolocation for a bit. Yeah, so if you go to PubSeq, and let me give you a little demo. So this is PubSeq, and what we hear is we have a map here, and we can click on the map, and we can explore sequences. So these are 8 sequences uploaded by Georgia in last year. And I click on one, and this takes you to some metadata, and the metadata will take you to a permanent link, for example. Oh, that's this one, sorry. It could take you to the sample type. Yeah, so it says it's a biospecimen collected from the back of the throat by swabbing. You get the sequence, of course. And you get some metadata here. Yeah, so this sample was taken from, let me see, where do I find it? It doesn't say here where it's from, but it's, let's see, identifiers, okay. So it was taken from the Japanese version of GenBank. And everybody recognizes this output. But what is key here is that, you know, this data is not so easily accessible. And where do we find the location? You know, where was it from? It says here, country is Georgia, okay? So if you were to process this data for yourself, let's say you are a bioinformatician in Utrecht, and you say, I want to look at these sequences. To get to this metadata, you would have to fetch this information and put it somewhere on the map, right? So what we decided to do with PubSeq is to use metadata, and we normalize it. And we normalize it in this case for collection location to wiki data. So if I click this link, take this link, paste it in, enter. And we chose Wikidata because it has all this information of a country, and it does not only give information about the number of people who live there, but also about the coordinates of the country, which we are used to put it on the map. Yeah, so it has a coordinate system in there. So Wikidata is the backend for Wikipedia, and it has a lot of information that we can use for further analysis. Ambiguity is a really important problem. If you have a sample that was taken in Memphis, you know, is it taken in Memphis, Tennessee? Is it taken in Memphis, Indiana? Is it taken in Memphis, Texas, or in Memphis, Egypt? So with the Wikidata URL here, or URI we call it, it will take you to Memphis, Tennessee, and it is disambiguated. It means that every sample that is marked up with this entry, we know it is from one place. So what more do we do? We normalize sampling information. So how was the sample taken? Was it a nasal swab, or was it from poo? We normalize the sequencing platform. We normalize for the protocol. Was it the Arctic, or was it something else? We normalize for analysis tools. And this information, you know, you'd have a really hard time pulling from public resources such as GenBank and EBI and others, even from GizAid. Do we want more metadata? Yes. Yeah. Environmental information is really interesting. We can get some of that from public resources such as Wikidata. So, for example, population density would be an interesting one, right? And we could pull it directly, you know, using this geo URL that we are using from Wikidata. Clinical data, that's much harder. When we opened up PubSeq, we added fields for clinical data, and we found that very few people use them. So it's a difficult subject. I'm not going to get into that right now, or not again. I'm using a different keyboard, that's why. So we add value. We list important mutations, and that, EBI also does. And next train, we find the nearest neighbor. The others do that too. We do a phylogeny. We do that too. They do that too. But we also add value by creating pangenomes, for example. Yeah, so that's a thing that we can do. What is also important is that we have live analysis workflows. So if you contribute to PubSeq in some way, you can change the workflows that we have. There was one news article quite recently in April It's called Vitama Dose, and there was a French hacker who essentially gave people the opportunity to get to collect a vaccine from somewhere in France where they had, you know, where they had an oversupply. So it was a you know, social networking type thing. And everybody's asking, why can't the French government do this? Yeah, and I think with PubSeq, we're a little bit about hacking. Yeah, PubSeq is both a hacker resource and also a resource with impact. And the main thing is anyone can join, you know, whether you're in Sri Lanka or in Kenya or in the Netherlands, it doesn't matter. Anyone can contribute. And then we have initiatives like from Miles Benton and Joop, which he showed on just a minute ago, where they're working on affordable hardware. And what can you do with that? And our mission at this point is to create a global on-the-spot variant detection system using cheap technology and public compute. There's a lot of information in there, but you can only do that when you have a number of factors like cheap hardware. So the Oxford Nanopore suffices, and Joop is showing that the Oxford Nanopore gives excellent results. A mini GPU can do the base calling locally and also dehumanize the data. So both the Nanopore and the GPU can dehumanize. The viral sequence can be uploaded into PubSeq directly, and we've already done a pilot of that. And when it gets uploaded, it triggers some of the workflows, right? And what we really want to do is to incense people to get these Oxford Nanopores and GPUs, package them in a bag with lab materials, and send them to places like India and Africa. So why do we need this public data then? Well, remember they said that the virus does not mutate in the early days. Remember that the virus would get weaker. It didn't. Yeah, so we need to track new mutations because our testing tools are based on also on the sequence material. We need to detect the active mutations, yeah, which has a real impact for vaccination. The earlier we know which mutations are active, the earlier we can work on new vaccines. Do we really know what is happening in India or Africa? Answer is plain no. We hardly know what's happening here. Mutants will surface eventually. So we will track them, but is that good enough? When it comes to data, Mark said last week, he always gives one of the best days of the course. Make data as private as it needs to be. Yeah, so it's actually in conjunction with FAIR data. And to say this, you know, in a different way, make data as public as possible, right? So if you have data, sequence data in particular, for viruses, why should we hide them? You know, why do we put them behind barriers? Why do we put them behind doors? Does viral data need to be protected? Does human data need to be protected? Yes, it does. Does human clinical data need to be protected? Of course it does, right? So those are not the questions, but why are we hiding viral data? We don't know. Why do we need online compute to analyze and mine data effectively? Yeah, and there's a thing here because especially Europe and the US are freeing up a lot of money to sequence coronavirus today. And they're giving out huge contracts to companies like Illumina, who by the way, they have a week turnaround time to get results. But the thing is that, you know, people are dealing with the sequencing, they often lack the bioinformatics itself. So how do we share these resources? And, you know, that's where I'm coming from. And the funding often is for sequencing. It's not for data analysis or for writing software. And then the sidetrack is, you know, when we have hidden data or data that's not readily available or sitting behind doors, how do you get reproducible analysis? Do you need to, you know, open that door somehow? And how do you reanalyze the data easily? So PubSeq, you know, and these open data repositories are really about making it possible to reanalyze data. And that's why we should be sending our sequences there. Why do we need public data? To make online compute possible. That's my message. Without public data, there's no open sharing of data. If you try the Nextstrain tooling on the internet, you know, they give great figures. And it's really amazing work. You know, I have no criticism about that at all. But trying to get the actual sequence is not possible because they're using GIS-8 information. Without public data, there's no online compute possible. That's saying the same thing in a way. Without public data, there's no easy sharing of methods and workflows. Everybody has to reinvent the wheel over and over again. Without public data, analysis is hard and often impossible to reproduce. During this pandemic, it has become very, very visible. And I think we, you know, it's a long-term problem we need to address, but we can start here. So with PubSeq, what have we achieved today? We have an online compute platform that is running in the common workflow language, the CWL. This cloud platform is sponsored by Amazon Open Data. So we are within the Open Data Initiative. Amazon also sponsored some of the compute, and Curie also sponsored some of the compute and the programming. We have a virtual HPC setup at SARA in Amsterdam, run by championed by Seth Swart and Michael Crusoe, which can also be used as a backend for PubSeq. We have permanent identifiers and federated data, mostly using the international, interplanetary file system, they call it, yeah. And the Amazon Open Data Initiative also hosts things like TCJ and NCBI Sequence Read Archive, etc. Yeah, so it's not a minor thing. They're really sponsoring this work. PubSeq has also triggered some innovation. Mostly, we're working on methods for pangenomes with SARS-CoV-2. Eric Garrison, who gave a talk earlier at UBC, is heavily involved. We are, for example, working on methods for large-scale phylogeny, because if you do 150,000 sequences, and maybe 1.5 million sequences, it's very, it doesn't scale to do the phylogeny. It's a quadratic problem, or semi-quadratic. It's also a demonstration platform for best practices. We apply CWL, RDF, Arvados, for example, free software. And also, it's an example of how to do metadata normalization, because we had a request from Elixir EBI how we did things. How can I contribute? If you're listening, you can help analyze data. You can add features, fix stuff. It's all about being open. It's an open initiative. We also, when you upload data into PubSeq, it can be exported to GenBank and EBI, and vice versa. If you upload to GenBank and EBI, it will get into PubSeq. We have a chat which I'll share. The take-home message is really that FAIR data should be as free and open as possible, but FAIR doesn't necessarily mean open, right? So-called public repositories are often not free and open, and even proper public repositories such as GenBank and EBI ANA lack support for metadata and online compute. Maybe they will do it in 10 years' time, I don't know. But at the moment, there seems to be, they're essentially databases online and lack proper metadata analysis. So PubSeq is really about queryable metadata. PubSeq is about online reproducible workflows. And we have a mission. Yeah, we have the global on-the-spot FAIR end detection using cheap hardware. There are too many people I can thank here, but I really want to thank these people. Andrea, who has done a lot of the work for programming, Peter and Sasha for Curie, Joop and Miles, Eric Garrison for Pangenomes, Michael Crusoe for CWL, Thomas Liedner for RDFing and normalization, Jervin, who does a lot of the RDF and Spotgy stuff, and Spotgy is Pangenomes for the semantic web, Mark Wilkinson for FAIR, Alex Kanitz for GH4GH, and some other people are heavily involved in contributing software. Thank you.